Hello, welcome or welcome back to my channel and welcome to my March and April wrap-up. So I didn't do a March wrap-up because in March I only read 4 books because I was going through a reading slump, and so, you know, I didn't want to do a wrap-up just for 4 books because that's not fun. But then in April I read 17, which might not be that much for some people, but for me personally is a lot. I don't think I've ever read 17 books in a month. And so now I have 21 books to talk about. So let's just get started. And the first books I read were actually part of the same series, and they were The Rage of Dragons and The Fires of Vengeance, which are books 1 and 2 in the Burning series. And they're also the only 2 books that are currently out in this series. And so in this series, we follow a boy named Thao, and he is trying to get revenge on the people who basically destroyed his life. And to be able to do that, he has to enter the army. But in this world, in his society, there are 2 big groups of people. So they are the nobles and the lessers. And Thao is a lesser, and there are different armies for the nobles and the lessers. And so he needs to enter the army of the lessers. And in the first book, we see him basically going through all the training and all of that. I mean, apart from that, this is a fantasy series. I think I forgot to say this is a fantasy series. So obviously in a fantasy setting where people have different types of magic and there are dragons and there are demons and there is a lot going on. And there is also a war starting. And this book was, I mean, these 2 books were just very painful, they were devastating, but I also love them, and I also love the main character, even when he didn't do exactly the right choices, because that did happen sometimes. But I love them, and I love the books. And in the first one, I love the beginning, because it started off very, very intense, and I love the ending, which was also very intense. But I feel like in the middle, it's not that I was bored, but we were just seeing a lot of the same thing. Like I said, the training and all of that. And so I loved it, but it wasn't like perfect for me. And I gave it 4 stars. And the second one, I just loved everything about it. And I gave it 5 stars. Then I read Nana, which was a horror book. And in this one, we followed Monica. And she had never met her birth mother. And when the woman who raised her died and they were at the funeral, she actually does meet her birth mother. And she seems to want to, you know, connect with her and get to know her. And so she ends up moving into Monica's house. And weird things start happening once she moves in, and not only to Monica, but to pretty much the whole family, like her husband and her kids and everyone. Just there are a lot of weird things going on. And I just thought that from the blurb of the book, it was pretty obvious what was happening. And so I was expecting to have like another reveal, either like exactly why it was happening, how it was happening, but we didn't really get any other reveals and we didn't get any explanations. And so, you know, I wanted more, but it did have some pretty creepy, gross scenes, which I did appreciate. So, I mean, it was okay, and I give this one 3 stars. Then I read A Day of Fallen Night, which is the prequel of The Priory of the Orange Tree, and this is a fantasy series, and these books are always so hard to explain without spoiling what's going on, because there is a lot going on. And we are basically following 3 main characters, 3 women, and they are from different kingdoms, different regions in this world. And they all have duties that they don't want to do, understandably so, because they are not fun. And there are also dragons in this one, and the different kingdoms have very different views of dragons in general, and there are other specific dragons that they all kind of have the same views on. And there is also a sort of magical secret society, and there is like the force of evil that everyone is trying to keep away. And I really like this, and I mean, I was, you know, really invested in the plot and the characters, because I really liked all of the characters we were following. And I especially liked one of the characters that was like not one of those main 3. And there is actually one romance in this book that I cared about, which is very, very rare for me to care about any romance. And so I did really enjoy everything, but I feel like the problem I had with it is that since this was a prequel and I have read The Priory of the Orange Tree before, so I knew like what the world was like after this book, so the stakes were not that high because like I knew what would go right and what would go wrong, sort of. So like if I had read this one first, obviously I wouldn't have had this problem, but reading it in this order, I just felt like the stakes were not that high. And I mean, I still really, really enjoyed it. I had a lot of fun with it. And I also felt a lot of pain with it. So it was still a great time. And I gave it 4 stars. Then I read City of Glass and City of Fallen Angels, which are books 3 and 4 in the Mortal Instruments series, which is part of the Shadowhunters series world thing. And yeah, and honestly, like I read one in March and one in April, and the one I read in March, I don't really remember, not like what happened, I remember what happened, I just don't remember what I felt about it, like, because I feel like, even though I mean I do remember it was my favorite because the plot was actually interesting, I was invested in what was going on, but as usual, the characters were the main issue because I don't really like any of them, I don't really care about any of them, at least like the main ones. So that was, you know, the issue. But in terms of the plot, I know that I was actually interested in what was going on, and I gave that one 3.5 stars. And then City of Fallen Angels, I read in April, and this one, like, the plot was not enough to like make it up for the characters being annoying, and I feel like, you know, maybe it should have ended as a trilogy because it had like sort of a conclusion for like the main thing that was happening before, and now I'm just like, what are we doing? I did not have a lot of fun with this one, and I gave it 2.5 stars, but honestly that is me being generous because I didn't really, you know, I didn't really like it. But I mean, the fact that I was reading this with my friend and we were like talking about it, I guess it made the experience better. And so 2.5 stars. Then I read The Poisoner's Handbook, which is nonfiction and is like crime and history. And it talks about, you know, different poisons and their history in the 1920s. Yeah, I think it starts in 1918. In New York. I love this because I am a forensic scientist, so this is just, you know, the kind of thing that I like to learn about, but if this is not the kind of thing you like to learn about, I would probably not recommend it because it is just very, like, informative, you know? So, me personally had a lot of fun with it, and I gave it 4 stars, especially because, like, there were a lot of funny moments. There were also a lot of disturbing moments that I would not recommend, but overall, it was very fun, and I gave it 4 stars. Next, I read City of Nightmares, and this was one of my anticipated releases, and it's the first book in a duology, I think, fantasy duology. And in this one, we followed Ness, or Nessa, I never remember what her name is, because that's how memorable she was. But we followed her, and in this world she lives in, if you dream, you turn into your worst nightmare. And there are like ways to prevent it, things that you can drink or like pills that you can take, they can prevent you from dreaming, which is what most people do. But sometimes accidents happen, or sometimes people just want to become a nightmare for some reason. And that can either be like some sort of creature, some sort of animal, or like something more abstract. And when you turn into a nightmare, again, depending on what you turn into, you can still have like your human mind, or you can just truly become a monster in every sense. And Ness's sister had become a nightmare years ago, and now she is in, like, she's part of an organization that is also sort of a cult, and they deal with the most violent nightmares, like they eliminate them. And I mean, that was what was in the blurb of the book, which I mean, sounded interesting, but then the book was kind of like about something else. I mean, that was part of the story, but there was also like an explosion, an assassination attempt, that I was like, where is this coming from? And I mean, honestly, the book was mostly about that. Ness trying to figure out why that was happening, like who were the targets, why she was sort of involved in that. And I mean, that was in theory fun, but I didn't really like her. And I didn't like the sort of romance that was going on, but never really got anywhere, but was kind of starting to go somewhere. I don't know. I didn't really like that. And also there were like some comments that felt like it was just the author saying, you need to think this way. Like, this is the right way to think. This is not a discussion. You need to think this way. Which again, whether I agreed with it or not, didn't really like it to have it like said in that way. And so, again, didn't really love it, but also it was entertaining. Like, I read it, like, I listened to it in a day because I was, what was I doing? Was I drawing? Was I doing a puzzle? I don't know. I was doing something, like, with my hands, and I was just listening to the audiobook, and I listened, like in one sitting, pretty much. So, I mean, it was entertaining, but it was nothing that I really enjoyed that much, and I gave it 2.5 stars. Then I read The Daughters of izdihar, and this was another anticipated release and another first book in a fantasy duology. And in this one, we followed Nahil, and she was a water weaver. And she just wanted to go to the academy where she could learn how to use her powers. But she could not go because she needed permission from her father, and he would not give it to her because he wanted her to marry some rich guy. And so she does marry that guy who's called Nico, and then they make a deal for him to let her go into the academy because he also wants something from her. And Nico is actually in love with someone else, a woman called Georgina, and she is an earth weaver. And she actually has very dangerous, uncontrollable powers. And she's also part of a women's rights group that is called the Daughters of izdihar. And so basically Nahil and Georgina are brought together because they just have a lot of common goals. And I really like both of them, and I really like the plot as well. I was very invested, and I really like to learn, especially with Nahil, how to use her powers and learn how the powers kind of came to be, even though we still have a lot of questions. It was very interesting to learn that, and I had a lot of fun with this. And like the end, I was just like, oh shit, for very different reasons for both main characters. Because for one, like, in a very good way, because what happened was very good. But for the other, what happened was very, very bad. So I am anxiously waiting for book two to come out eventually. Like, I need to know what happens. And yeah, I had a lot of fun with this, and they gave it 4 stars. Then I read 3 books that were a series. And so that was The Final Empire, The Well of Ascension, and The Hero of Ages. And these are the 3 books in the Era 1 of the Mistborn series, I think, which is part of the Cosmere universe. And in these books, we are following the characters that are kind of starting a rebellion, a revolution, because the man in charge of this world, who's called the Lord Ruler, is a tyrant, and he just treats people badly, and some of them are treated as slaves. And so we are seeing the beginning of a revolution. And also in this world there is magic, and it is connected to metals. There are a few different metals that people can use for different powers, and most people can only use one metal that gives them one kind of power. But there are some special people, the Mistborns, who can use all the metals and basically have all the powers. And so the main character we're following is a Mistborn, and then he meets another Mistborn. And they are both playing very important roles in this rebellion. And I really, really like this. I really like the characters. They were all amazing. And I really like the world building as well. And the magic system was just so unique. Like, I've never read any magic like this, and all the fight scenes where they use the magic were amazing. And I mean, I was invested in the plot from literally page one. And so to book one, The Final Empire, I gave 4.5 stars. To book two, which was The Well of Ascension, I also gave 4.5 because in the beginning, I was really enjoying it, but not as much as book one. But then the end was absolutely insane, and so also 4.5 stars. And then the third and last, the Hero of Ages, I loved from beginning to end, and the end definitely broke my heart, and I gave this one 5 stars. Then I read some horror books, and the first one was The Trees Grew Because I Bled There. And this was a short story collection, and they were all centered around grief and, in a way, around children as well. And children are incredibly creepy, scary, terrifying. And this was a lot of fun, and as always with this author, it was disturbing and traumatizing, which was exactly what I wanted. And yeah, I had a great time with it, and I gave it 4 stars. Then I read A House with Good Bones, and this was also a horror book. And in this one, we were following Sam, and she went back to her mom's house to visit, but everything was strange, both the house and her mom, because her mom was just acting very unlike herself, and she was just acting very jumpy and scared. And the house was also like, the decorations were different, the way everything looked was different, but also there was a jar of teeth in the rose bushes, and there were also vultures circling. And there were a lot of strange things happening as well. And the thing is, from the beginning, I thought like the reason for the haunting was pretty obvious. And that is not necessarily a problem if we have something else, like, you know, if it's just creepy or if it's just unsettling, if I just feel uncomfortable, which is, I mean, it's what I want from a book and it's what I have gotten before from books from this author. So I was expecting that, but I wasn't really feeling it. Like, I wasn't feeling anything with this book. And then at the like maybe 60% mark or a little further, it did finally get kind of creepy and actually exciting. Like, things were happening. So I did like the second half of the book. It was fun, but it was still just an okay book overall, and I gave it 3 stars. And then I read 1922, and this one opens up with a confession of a man talking about what happened in 1922. And we learned that he owned a farm, and his wife owned the land right next to it, but she wanted to sell her part and she wanted to move away from that area, but the man didn't want that. He wanted to keep his land and he wanted to keep living there. And we see that he's willing to do anything to keep living there. And this was insane in the best way possible. And this one definitely made me feel very uncomfortable. And it had a lot of disgusting scenes. And I really enjoyed this one and I gave it 4 stars. Then I read 2 books from a series, and they were Map of Bones and Kowalski's In Love. And these were books 2 and 2.5 of the Sigma Force series. And I mean, in this series in general, we follow obviously the Sigma Force group, and they are a group of people who are either scientists or people who are very good with technology, and they also have military training. And in this book specifically, Map of Bones, there have been a attack in a church. I think it was in Germany, but I might be wrong because we went through a few countries in this book. But there was an attack in a church and things were stolen, but nothing that people would normally consider as a treasure, like all the gold that was there. What was stolen were bones. And then we learned that the bones had some special properties. And so we see the Sigma Force investigating, trying to track the bones, they kind of follow like a treasure hunt, because that's why we go through so many different countries, because there were various steps until we got to the last place. And the plot was very fun. The whole mystery was interesting, but I didn't really care about the characters. And in the beginning, I was just listening to the audiobook. And honestly, I didn't know who anyone was. I didn't know anyone's names. And whenever they came up, I was just like, who are you exactly? So I wasn't really, you know, connecting to the characters, but then I started reading the ebook, and I mean, it definitely helped. And but still, I didn't really care about them. But the plot itself was interesting, and I gave it 3.5 stars. And then Kowalski's in Love was like very short. It was, I think, under 30 pages, and it was just basically introducing a new character, Kowalski. And I think, according to the comments, he's gonna be part of the series now in a lot of books, which I am excited about because he was really funny. And I mean, the book itself, novella, short story, whatever it was also really funny, but I mean, it was very, very short, so it couldn't really give me that much, but yeah, it was fun, and I gave it 3 stars. Then I read The Skeleton Tree, and this was a horror book, or so I thought, because we were following Wendy, and she wanted to buy a house that was for sale that she was kind of like obsessed with, but it was so expensive, and she never thought that she would actually be able to afford it. But then she came into some unexpected money, and so she managed to move into her dream house with her husband and their 3 kids. And then someone that was related to the previous owners actually visited Wendy, and they were talking about the house and their experiences there, the time they spent there, and that other person said that maybe the house was haunted, like they had experienced some weird things going on. And I mean, that got me excited because I love haunted house stories, but it wasn't actually scary, it wasn't creepy, nothing weird, uncomfortable, terrifying was happening. I was just like, what is going on exactly? Because the only thing we were really seeing was the family drama of Wendy and her husband and their kids, especially like one of the kids. And I was just like, this is not what I came here for. This is not what I was promised. And so I think like the main issue is that this was not a horror book. At least I would not consider it a horror book. There was like one thing that could be horror, like that happened at the end of the book, but it was literally at the end. I didn't even get to enjoy it. And so yeah, I did not like this one, and I gave it 2 stars. And then I read Awe, and this was literary fiction, which was definitely out of my comfort zone, and I was a little scared going into it. But we were following 3 POVs, and 2 of them were from 2 brothers, Arama and Taukiri, and they had recently lost their parents, and so Taukiri, who was the oldest, left his little brother at their aunt and uncle's house. And we were just, you know, pretty much following their day-to-day lives, how they were obviously dealing with the trauma of losing their parents and their new lives they were adjusting to. And they were both really, really sad. And then the other POV we got was from actually 2 characters, Jade and Toko. And I mean, their lives were also very, very sad. And like the writing of this book was incredibly beautiful, but I feel like it made the sadness even like more intense, and there were a lot of times I was reading that I like had to stop and take a second because it was like it hit so hard, and I was just like not okay. And the end of this book, like if I had watched it, you know, on a screen, like as a TV show or a movie or something, I probably would have cried because it got me very emotional. But I don't really cry with books, but I was very emotional, and I really loved it. It destroyed me, but in the best way possible. But I mean, I would definitely check the trigger warnings to read this book because there are a lot of them. But I really, really loved it, and I gave it 5 stars. We are nearing the end. We only have 2 books left. And the next one was Season of Storms, which is the prequel, but also last book of the Witcher series. And it should definitely be read as the last book because there was something here like towards the end that would spoil the end of like the main story. So I would definitely recommend this being read last. And in this story, we are following obviously Geralt, and his swords are stolen, and so he's trying to figure out who stole them, where they are, how he can get them back. But there is actually a whole other plot that I was not expecting, but it was very fun. And I mean, mostly I was here to just enjoy Geralt and, Jaskier slash Dandelion being friends and, you know, hanging out. And I mean, that is exactly what I got. And it was like nothing that I was crazy about. It was not like my favorite book in the series, but it was still a very fun time. And I give it 3.5 stars. And then finally, I read Daughter of the Moon Goddess. And this was the first book in a fantasy duology. And we are following Qingyan, who is the daughter of the Moon Goddess. And she lives in the moon with her mom. And we quickly learn that they live there because her mom had been exiled. And she has to stay on the moon. And one day, Qingyan's powers, like, they show themselves. And that is not a good thing, because now she has to run and she has to leave the only place she's ever known and the only people she's ever known. And she's trying to make it in the Celestial Kingdom, and she cannot reveal her identity, but she actually gets to train with the Emperor's son. She gets to train both her magic and also archery. That's what she ends up choosing to train. And while she's doing all of that, she still has the plan, the goal to save her mom. And I really like the plot in the main character, but I feel like there was a little too much romance for me, and I didn't really care about it. And it's not that I like hated it, but I didn't like it either. And there was a little too much of it for me to be able to enjoy it as much as I would if there was no romance, or if I liked the romance. And but I think this is a me thing, because I think everyone loved the romance in this series, so don't take my word for it. I don't like romance in general. But the plot itself was very fun, was very entertaining, and like I said, I really liked the main character. And I did have fun with this book, but I don't know if I will read the second book. At least I won't be reading it now, because it had like a satisfying enough conclusion. There is also more stuff to the story to be resolved, but it was satisfying enough, at least for now. I'm good with where I am, and yeah, I give it 3.5 stars. And so those were the 21 books I read in the past 2 months, and that is everything for this video. Thank you so much for watching. I really hope that you have enjoyed it, and if you did, give it a like and subscribe, and I will talk to you next time. Bye!